An angel came to see Mary.
She was doing laundry, and then the angel just appeared and she was really scared.
So Gabriel was like, Mary, you're gonna have what? Mary, you're gonna have a baby. You're gonna have a baby. You will call him Jesus. And then Mary was like, I'm not gonna have a baby yet. I'm only a teenager. I'm not married. Then the angel Gabriel tells Joseph that Mary is not lying. You are having a new baby. And so they met up. They went to Bethlehem, which was Joseph's old town.
They ride a donkey.
Oh, a camel.
Oh, yeah, a camel.
She said, this donkey's fast.
Well, they tried to go to a hotel, and they asked the keeper for a place to stay. The keeper said,
we have no room. Literally, no room.
So Mary and Joseph walked away sadly, but then he said,
the only place in here in Bethlehem that you can stay is a stable. And then he just pointed the way they followed.
When the shepherds were taking care of the sheep,
they saw it.
The angel said, a new baby is being born to the king of the Jews.
The angel was singing.
Yes. And then the shepherds said, I think we should go there and meet him. Second, Christ said, yeah, I agree with you. And the other said, yeah, me too. They had to walk through a bunch of grass and bushes. Maybe have to camp out at night. And then the wise men heard about it, and then a star appeared.
Well, we should probably follow that star. It's flaming down to the barn.
So maybe we should follow it. Maybe. So the wise men went to Jesus.
They gave them gifts.
It's the family, it's a simple one.
Some diapers, some wine, some milk, some shoes, some Jordans,
girlfriend, and grandma.
And I don't know how it would survive in that barn. Too stinky, too crowded, and cold.
I think he probably, because the room is very small. Thank you for coming.
He's adorable.
He's going to be our best friend.
I love you, and you're the best baby I ever seen. That's the
thing. New baby is going to change the world.
All right, good morning, everybody. Well, as you can see, this is our Children's Sunday, and we're glad that each and every one of you have chosen to be out and worshiping with us here together. We are entering just an exciting time of the year when we are preparing for Christmas, and obviously that means a few things are happening around here. Our main ministry at this time is our live nativity that is coming up next weekend, and we want to, of course, invite all of you to be able to be a part of that. It's a great time for us to be able to get the real meaning of Christmas to people in our community. You know, folks are out there, throughout the course of this season, and they're spending all of their money and, buying all these presents and hitting the stores, and, Christmas has become so much about materialism, but we know that Christmas is about much more than that. It's about the birth of Jesus Christ, who came into the world, God's one and only Son, lived a perfect life, but then died a sacrificial death, rose from the grave, and is coming back again. Amen? That's really what Christmas is all about. It's about the coming of a Savior for each one of us to deliver us from our greatest problem, which was sin. And that's what we rejoice in. That's where our joy comes from, that salvation is available through Jesus Christ. Now, our nativity sign-ups, this is our last week for the nativity sign-ups, because, again, we're going live this weekend, coming up. We are right now at about 71% capacity as far as all of our actors, coming in. So that means that we're about 30% short of what we need to be able to staff all of the scenes around the building. Now, what that means is that, I mean, we need to ask God and we need to ask you folks to be able to come out and to be a part of what's going on. We've already advertised this as an all-hands-on-deck ministry, and we really mean that. We need everybody to be able to participate. And so what can I do? Well, there's, it's pretty simple. I mean, basically, you come, we put you in a little costume, make sure you dress warm when you come. There are some cold temperatures and some crazy weather predicted, but, you know, the Lord's in control. Dress warm, preferably without something with a hood, so that your costume can cover it effectively, and you don't look like you're like the Hunchback of Notre Dame out there. You know, we don't want that. Just, you know, dress warm. You come out, we put you in a character, you go out, you stand around, and you do some basic hand actions, and people see you, they drive around, they hear the message of the birth, the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus. And we get that message to the community. So that's what we need you to do. So in the back, toward the right side back there, you will see a nativity sign up. So go back and sign up. Be a part of what's going on. What better way to celebrate Christmas than to serve the one who came for us? So we need about 30% to be able to get back there to finish off our staff. Also, there will be four tables in the back as well. That will represent our four small groups that are starting up. These are in-home Bible studies that you can be connected with. If you're new to the church, if you're a visitor, if you're just, you know, struggling to kind of, you know, meet people, and you mean a church of this size is a little intimidating, well, it's a great way to be able to break down the congregation into a little smaller bites. So you can get to know a group of people, you can get some intimate relationships started with them, and have some great fellowship around God's Word, maybe a meal together, those type of things. So after the service this morning, we've been telling you about those. There'll be four back there. Go back, talk to somebody, sign up, and you'll be able to have that time just to break down those things. Coming up on the second week in January, we have a lot of changes to our service coming up. We have a new Sunday school time starting. We have a fellowship time taking place. There have been some bulletin inserts about that. You can check for all those latest details. And remember that our new Sunday school classes will be starting, you mean, during that time. Pastor Jace is going to be doing prophetic events. You want to know what God has laid out for the future? Come and participate in that. Alan is going to be doing the Sermon on the Mount, and so you can kind of pay attention to that there. It's one of those passages that just really great to be able to look into and to see there's a lot there, a lot going on. Seems simple at first. And then there's going to be a New Testament survey class done by Scotty. So how many people are doing that read through the Bible in a year thing with Scotty? Where are you folks at? There's got to be more of you than that. Come on. So you guys want to continue into the New Testament. Excuse me. That's going to be your class. And even if you're not reading through the Bible, I mean, you can also, you know, pick that up. You can start by reading through the New Testament. Or if you just want to know what the New Testament is all about, get a good overview of what these books contain. Scotty will be teaching a New Testament survey class there. And then I'll be doing a class on the misunderstood spirit, just dealing with who is the Holy Spirit, you know, what's going on, I mean, all of these crazy things that I hear about. You know, what is actually this God Spirit thing all about? We'll be studying the Holy Spirit in that class. So just take advantage of those changes, and we'd like everyone to be a part of that. So if you want to turn in your Bibles right now, Galatians chapter 4, I'm going to read the scripture for you and turn it over to Nick for some worship. So Galatians chapter 4, text for our message this morning. Galatians chapter 4, verse 1. What I am saying is that as long as the heir is a child, he is no different from a slave, although he owns the whole estate. He is subject to guardians and trustees until the time set by his father. And so also, when we were children, we were in slavery under the basic principles of the world. But when the time had fully come, God sent his son, born of a woman, born under law, to redeem those under the law, that we might receive full rights of sons. Because you are sons, God sent the spirit of his son into our hearts, the Spirit who calls out, Abba, Father. So you are no longer a slave, but a son. And since you are a son, God has made you also an heir. That's the note.
And as it is December, we'll be singing our favorite Christmas songs throughout the month. So please stand together as we sing, Go Tell on the Mountain.
Oh,
Continuing to learn our song of the month called Bethlehem. So if you'd like to stand and sing, that's fine. If you'd rather sit, it's okay. We're just going to be worshiping the Lord together.
Starlight in a mother's eyes, a holy child is born. Jesus shepherds on their knees, adoring Christ the Lord. Bethlehem, Bethlehem, behold your beautiful Savior. Oh, now, worship Him, the King born in Bethlehem. He knew the secrets of the world, His sister God gave. Let Him rise in flesh and blood, the Son of Majesty. Oh,
While I see it
such keen estate where ox and ass are feeding. The bridge of fear for sinners heal. The silent word is healing. Fear shall pierce into the rocks beyond for people. Fear the world may quest away the child of men. So bring him his that soul and myrrh, confessions seeming to own him. The King of Kings salvation brings, let loving hearts enthrone him. Raise the song on high, the virgin sings the lullaby. Joy, joy for Christ is born, the babe of God. This is Christ, the King, who swept the dark and ancient sins. Hey, you great, you Lord, the babe of God of Mary.
Call the ushers up forward, please, for the kids come on stage, have a word of prayer. Father, thank you so much for your amazing gift of taking on flesh, the Word becoming flesh and dwelling among us. It's an amazing thought that the God of the universe who exists in eternity past, comes down as a humble servant, lives among us, feels the pains that we feel, suffered and died for us. We thank you for your gift of love. Continue to strengthen us in it, in knowledge and grace and love. We can pass it on to our children as we'll be celebrating today. Thank you for your precious gift. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated.
While they are passing out the plates, I do want to remind you, or for some of you that are new, you know that the last Sunday of the year, we always have a special offering for the building needs. You know that we're in the process, or very near the process, of completing plans for the new auditorium. You also know that we do not take mortgages here at Berean Bible Church, so we have to have the money before we can, all the money raised, or enough money raised that we can proceed with the next steps with this. All the offering on the 25th is the last Sunday this year, so that offering will be a special building fund offering. And be in prayer about that. If you're not going to be here on Christmas Sunday because of family obligations, you can also designate any time for that. Also, remember, next Sunday morning is the Christmas Cantata at this 10:30 service. So it's kind of brief because of the drive-through and all things that we have here, but put that down. And then if you didn't get the Sunday morning schedule for the holidays that are upcoming, there are probably still some in the back. They were in the bulletin last week. But remember and pray about those things. Okay, here's one of our favorite things in the year as we bring the kids up. And first up is the nursery department. And so I'm going to take this mic over here and let them introduce themselves, and we'll pass it right down from one to the other.
Hi, I'm Rob Caruso. This is Molly Catherine Caruso, and her birthday is September 30th, 2016.
I'm Nick.
This is Hudson, and his birthday is, I think, September 22nd of last year. Three, sorry.
Hello, everyone.
I'm Drew Watkins. This is Valerie Grace Watkins, and her birthday is August 3rd, 2016.
My name is Paul Phillippe. This is also Paul Phillippe. He is a little over a year old, born October 8th.
I'm Bruce Stefanowitz. This is Jesse Lee Morton Stefanowitz. He was born April 29th.
I'm Brandon Holmes, and this is Lincoln Tyler Holmes, and his birthday is July 28th.
I'm Jim Fossey. This is Aurora Sephora Fossey, and she was born February 28th, almost 2 years ago.
My name is Chester Nye. This is Boaz Russell Nye, and his birthday is today, a year ago. So he's one today.
Okay, let's give the kids a round of applause, and thanks for bringing them up. When I was in the back earlier, I know a couple dads weren't sure about birth dates, so they might have made a couple of those up. I know the moms, they're in big trouble if they did. Terrible, you don't know the birth dates of your children. Okay. Now, twos and threes, I believe, are going to come. And you see the babies keep coming, folks, and I know those are working on it. And that's always been... Why is that so funny that others are working on it, Chester? Hey, we love babies at Berean. Keep them coming. Bring in the twos and threes. Okay, there's a bunch of twos and threes also. Let's see how they do. This is sure to be good for a couple laughs. I know. I'm so glad. 20? Oh. I'm so thankful for our young people having babies. I'm so glad I'm done with it. Yeah.
There you go. Good job. We got a drummer. We got a drummer. That takes more organization than a space flight. All right. Okay, and I guess this is the fours and fives and everybody else. Up to fifth, there's some up to fifth graders in this group here. By the way, we can always use Sunday school teacher help. Once a month, folks, you can do it. Please see me, Pastor Jeff, especially with the new system coming up. We do need some help. I think after Christmas there will be some information there what age groups we need. If you just give us one Sunday a month, and you get an opportunity to have an impact upon these precious lives.
Thank you.
At this time, I'd like to ask Chester and Anakay to come on up, and whatever family members are coming as well. Just, is there more or just the two of you? Oh, looks like they're coming up. Come on up. This looks like adopted families, too, and everything here. Okay. Wow, this is like three-quarters of the congregation coming up here. So I planned on having family introductions, but that might take us to the end of the service here. But, you know, what a great time for a child dedication. In that we have a perfect illustration of child dedication given to us in the Christmas story itself. There's a picture up on the screen here, which is of a story in the scriptures that we're told in the book of Luke, where 40 days after Mary had given birth, they took Jesus to the temple to be able to dedicate him to the Lord. And in that story, some really amazing things happened. There was the prophecy about the child and the things that he would do and the cost that would be to both Mary and Joseph. But what you see is, in that situation, a little bit of a glimpse of the ministry that Mary and Joseph had to Jesus. You know, we often talk about it in reverse, you know, the ministry that Jesus has to us and all the things that we had. But when Christ came into the world in that helpless baby, I mean, he needed those to be able to minister to him. And so he called out these two people, Mary and Joseph, who had found favor in God's sight, to be ones to be able to minister to him, to make sure that from the earliest age that all of the matters of the law concerning Jesus were being fulfilled. And they took that child there to the temple that day to offer that sacrifice to two young pigeons, to be able to honor the Lord, to be able to dedicate Jesus to God, to say to those around, "This child is not ours. He's just on loan to us. This child belongs to God." That's what they said. When we practice child dedication today, we want everyone to understand that this in no way has anything to do with the salvation of Boaz. That's a separate matter that he has to decide when he's old enough to be able to understand the message of the gospel, that Christ came and died for our sins and was raised again, and that through personal faith in him that we can be forgiven, we can have a home in heaven. That message, I mean, Boaz has to receive as he gets older. And so dedication is really not so much about the child himself, but about the ones that are raising that child, the ones in whom that child was entrusted. And that's Chester and Anakay. And so this is really a dedication of parents to that great task of raising children in a godless generation to be able to love and serve the Lord Jesus. That's really your task, and it's a difficult one. But you know the great thing is that you don't do that alone, do you? That you have, first and foremost, a group of friends and family here, the likes of which I've never seen on the stage of Berean Bible Church. And not only that, but you have friends here in the congregation that you've known for years, and you have new people that you've met, and you have a whole host of people here that will assist you, either by teaching Boaz in Sunday school, or by just being a friend to you guys, or by encouraging, offering advice through many different forms in many different ways. I mean, you don't raise Boaz alone. He's your primary responsibility, but you have help in that from a loving church family. And they're here for you. And so, I want to ask you guys a couple of questions here. I mean, as we get to the end, you can answer with an "I do." And so here they are. First of all, Chester and Anakay, do you promise to provide a godly environment for Boaz to be able to grow in the grace of the Lord Jesus? Do you promise to be able to teach Boaz God's word as he grows and becomes a young man? And do you promise to be able to pray for him to receive salvation at the earliest possible age? If so, answer, "I do."
"We do."
I guess the "we do" would be better, right? Yeah, probably since it's both of you. And now, what's your role in all of this? Well, you guys play a part, and so do you guys, in that we have to hold these two accountable for these promises that they made before God and these witnesses today, to be an encouragement to them that they would not fall away from God and neglect this responsibility for which they're here today. That's our job. That's all of our jobs, to raise our children to love the Lord in these desperate times. Amen? Would you all bow with me in a prayer of dedication? Father in heaven, I thank you so much for the gift of children. Lord, thank you for little Boaz, for his young life. Father, for all the potential that we possess to be able to accomplish things for your kingdom. Lord God, I ask that at the earliest possible age that Boaz would come to know you, and that, Lord, that he would see in family and in friends and in his church, and especially in his parents, that example of Jesus, that loving, nurturing environment that points a child to the Lord Jesus. And Father, to that end, we dedicate Boaz Russell Nye in the name of the living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And all God's people said, amen. All right, you're going to hold him up there, Chester? Here comes the Lion King moment. All right. All right. While they descend the stage, if you guys want to get your Bibles out and turn to the book of Galatians, we're going to get started there. In fact, before you do that, stand up, greet somebody while I turn. All right. Galatians chapter 4, verses 1 through 7. And we're really going to concentrate this morning just on verse 4 to the end there, 4, 5, 6, and 7, in the interest of time. You know, there's nothing better than a timely gift. Now, I don't know if you've ever received a timely gift, but I have. Now, there's a little bit of history here, and I want you guys to all know that I grew up in a home where we just went crazy at Christmas time. I had a loving mother who is here in the audience today, so I have to be careful what I say. But my mom, was just insisted that Christmas be just over the top as a time of joy and a time of gift-giving. And so, we had presents and, never lacked for, for the things that, young boys look forward to at Christmas time. But the other thing that she was very particular about is that we had to have Christmas socks. Now, is there any people out there that are like, we still do the Christmas sock, man, we put little things in the sock. Raise your hands, come on, any sock people out there? So, Mom, look around the audience, you're not alone. You weren't the only one to do that. Now, here's my next question, though. How many of you wrap the presents inside the socks, even if they're a pack of Chiclets? You people with your hands up, you're crazy. You have big problems. It's already hidden inside the sock. You don't have to wrap and all that stuff. But she did, every last one of them. Now, as a kid, it's easy because, in a sock, you can put candy and all these little things. But as you become older, what do you put in the sock for an almost 50-year-old man? It's kind of hard to think of things. And so she would, try to, come up with little things. Here is a one of those things you stick inside the grapefruit. You puncture it in there so you can suck the juice out of it. Okay, Mom, really? Come on. We're scraping the bottom of the barrel here. Well, I don't know what to get you, she would say. So then, I had to give a list of my own presents. And I'm like, well, Mom, isn't that going to defeat the purpose? And I don't know what I want in my sock. They're little trinkets, right? I don't know. Pack of Tic Tacs. But then I got wise. And I figured, there's probably some things that I could actually use that could be put in that sock that, would be valuable. And so I came up with a few things, like soap and deodorant and shampoo. Now, the reason why these gifts became so important is because they're very timely. Because if I played my cards right and I used the deodorant and the soap sparingly, I didn't have to buy any until the next year when I would get this again in my sock. But when you got to the beginning of December, things were kind of desperate. And so you're like, man, Mom, I hope you come through in the sock again this year. You're my degree antiperspirant. I need that can, man. I got to wear it on Sunday. So finally there it was. You'd open it up and, what a timely gift. Well, we read about a timely gift in our passage of Scripture. And that timely gift is, come on, folks, who's that timely gift? It's the Lord Jesus Christ. Absolutely. And as we kind of get to our scripture here, we already read it, so we'll skip through that. But as we come to the Christmas story here, we're going to take a look at it from a different perspective. We learn a lot about this timely gift in the Gospel of Matthew, and in Matthew we learn about the angel and Joseph and even that conversation about how he's to marry Mary despite all of these things. And they were betrothed, and we have the great accounts of the visits of the Magi, and Then, of course, we also, I mean, can read the Christmas story in Luke. And, of course, that's the great, you know, passages that contain the angel's conversation to Mary and the shepherds and that, you know, adorable scene. And, of course, Mary's great prayer. I mean, all of the things that Luke kind of contributes to the Christmas story. And we can even take a message from John. And we learn about the sweeping story of the gospel, the sweeping story of the pre-incarnate Christ, the Word who was made flesh, you know, there in the opening chapter of John. But you know what's interesting? Where's Paul's Christmas account? You got Matthew, you got Luke, you got John, but you know, where does Paul talk about Christmas? And I believe it's right here in this great passage. This section in Galatians is really one of the few, you know, instances where Paul talks at all about the birth of Christ. But yet this passage contains so much wonder in so few verses, in so few words. We're going to take a brief look at it here today. Dennis McLaren said this concerning, I mean, this great passage. He said, "The remaining portion of our text is so full of meaning that one shrinks from attempting to deal with it in our narrow space. But though it opens up depths beyond our fathoming and gathers into one concentrated brightness, light on which our dim eyes can hardly look, we may venture to attempt some imperfect consideration of even these great words." What a classic passage this is. Turn your attention to verse 4, if you would, please. Let's take a look at it. We read these words, "But when the time had fully come." If you think about that statement, we know that Christ wasn't born in the beginning of human history, that there were thousands of years of human history up until the point of the coming of Christ, now thousands of years in history to us. But did you ever wonder about why did Christ, you know, come at the time in which he did? You know, why did God send him then? I mean, the Scripture says here that it was in God's purpose, in God's perfect timing, in the fullness of time, at just the right time, the Scripture tells us. That phrase, I mean, or that expression is used of a ship that is fully loaded with cargo, and that hold of that ship being full. In the fullness of time, at the exact right moment in history, when everything had been accomplished, when God's plans had come to fruition, God sends his Son into the world, born of a woman. Why? Why that time in history? What was going on at the time? Just a few things. Number one, there was never before a time in the history, you mean, of the planet, when most of the known world spoke one common language. What was that language? What was the language of the New Testament world? You guys should know this, right? What was it? It was Greek. Common Greek. Brought about by the conquest of Hellenism, Alexander the Great, I mean, as he kind of stormed through the world, I mean, bringing Greek culture and language all over the place, so much so that many Jews did not even know Hebrew anymore. In fact, that's one of the things that Paul boasted about in some of his epistles. That he was a Hebrew of Hebrews, that he understood, he was able to read and speak Hebrew. But many Jews did not. Because their culture, you mean, was affected by the dominance of Greece. And so in the time in which, you know, Jesus is born, there is one common language that most people know. And of course, that opens the door, prepares the way for the message of the birth of Christ to spread throughout all of the nations, throughout all of the known world. And it couldn't have been possible up until that very moment in history when so many of the world's cultures and languages were so separated. But as Alexander the Great brings all the world together in one culture and one language, it's at that time, in that fullness, that Jesus Christ comes into the world. But not only that, but there's one world government. Who's the power in charge of the known world? It's Rome, right? You remember the Pax Romana, the Roman peace. And as they conquered all of these nations, they brought their peace to the nations. Now, be it under the thumb, it wasn't a time of upheaval and turmoil. They had brought this kingdom of relative peace for many, many, many years, over 1,000 years. And during that time, when things were fairly settled, not that there weren't unrest here or there, but it's at that very time when Christ is born, the complete time, conditions were right, God sends forth his Son. And not just those two things, but as well, the Romans were great at being able to create a system of transportation for mobility. You've heard of the Roman roads. They created these pathways made with stone, worked on mostly by conquered peoples, placed throughout all the major trade routes so that now, unlike any other time in history, the world was interconnected. You know, we talk about globalism today, right, through the internet and through, commerce with different nations. Well, this was the first globalism that the Romans brought to the world. The ability to travel quickly between places in safety as the roads were guarded. And that's where they were taken care of. You could move wagons and you could move goods and you could sell them around. And so there was the ability for people to come and go throughout the whole Roman world. And again, that opens the door for the message of the gospel to be spread everywhere. And one more thing, and there are others. These are the four that I picked out for us this morning. One more thing is that God was also preparing hearts. Three major religious groups of people. You had the Gentiles that served and worshipped all of the pantheon of gods. You know, all of their different, cultural, gods that have been, historic, that have, stretched back, for, ages and time past. You had the Romans, which basically continued on. The religion of the Greeks, which were these, heroes and demigods, and they're all the different, ones, the statues everywhere in the towns. These statues dedicated to these various gods. And then, of course, you had the Jews. And you had the Jewish people and their long history of, being under the law of Moses. Having to offer sacrifices every time they messed up. Having to go to the temple. All of the expense. All of the constant reminders of all of the things that they had done wrong. And we know that at that time, the time that Christ was born, that the Jews were going through a tremendous time of darkness. Remember, because of Jewish disobedience to God's law, they had been sold into slavery. They were under Roman domination. Remember that no prophet had spoken to the nation in over 400 years. The time between Malachi and the opening of the New Testament, they call those the silent years. Not because nothing happened, but because God had not spoken to the people through a prophet. And so many Jewish people thought that maybe God had given up on them, or was so angry that he had abandoned them, or that maybe he wasn't real. Many were living under the threat, under the constant burden of obedience to the law, and they were becoming increasingly frustrated, increasingly beaten down with the constant reminders of failure after failure after failure to live up to the righteous standards of the law. They were becoming, again, disenchanted with having to continually offer expensive sacrifices for sin over and over and over again to be able to restore their fellowship with God. Many of the conquered peoples had lost faith in their gods. Because remember, in the mind of the Old Testament world, the New Testament world, if your nation got defeated by another nation, then that was proof or evidence that your God was stronger than theirs. And so many people became disillusioned with their gods. And they were like, man, maybe they're not gods at all. And so all of the centuries of these types of worship were growing old to people. Romans, Greeks, Jews, and other people. And so there was a restlessness in the hearts of people. And of course, God was going to use them. Folks were looking for something new, something better. The Jews were looking for the fulfillment of the promises, many giving up hope in them. And with all these things listed here on our PowerPoint, can you see that that phrase is wonderful? But when the time had fully come, simply amazing. The way had been prepared. Hearts had been prepared. The world was in the perfect set of conditions for God's Son to come to bring salvation to mankind. And for that message to spread. Boy, God's timing is perfect, isn't it? He knows what he's doing. What do we see when we look back? We see the spread of the gospel. We see how quickly Christianity caught fire, how hearts were hungry, and how many, many people received the gift of salvation. And so in that fullness of time, next phrase, God sent forth his Son. You know, as much as those things were right, it was God's ultimate wisdom in desiring to send a Savior that caused him to bring his Son into the world. Now, I wonder what would happen if, you decided to come up with a plan for how the coming of Jesus would have worked. You know, what would your plan have been? So, you got to send your Son into the world. What's that going to look like? Now, we would have had all kinds of plans. Now, I had a couple ideas on this. Like, maybe Jesus could have came as, like, a superhero, like, with a cape. Or maybe one of those guys with, like, a big sword, like some kind of massive, like, you know, Arnold Schwarzenegger warrior type, you know, and, you know, just be able to go around and, you know, demanding, you know, people's allegiance. You know, somebody that the world would have recognized, somebody that the world would have noticed. I mean, that probably would have been my plan, you know, to bring about the coming of God's Son. But I'm very thankful that I wasn't the one that planned that out, but that God was. And I want you to think about for a minute the wonder of what happens there. Just think for one second. You know, all of these ages of history, all of, you mean, the background in the Old Testament. You know, why did God allow these people to go through this time? Because God was showing over and over and over again, ingraining in our minds, in the people's hearts, that our absolute bondage to sin and our need for a Savior. That's what God was demonstrating. That's why, I mean, so many years had gone by with people, you know, floundering under the law. God was making that point clear, that we cannot live up to the righteous standards of God. That we had a great need for someone to come and save us. See, there was nothing wrong with the law. Paul says the law is holy and righteous and good. The law revealed the standards of God. The law said, this is what you have to live up to be worthy of my righteousness. The problem is, nobody could do it. Nobody could live up to that standard. And so over and over again, we were reminded of our failure. And then, but God provided a system of sacrifices by which people could make themselves right with God again. But think about that over and over and over again. Put yourself in that Jewish religion. And think about what that was like. The constant reminders of failure and God's gracious forgiveness through those sacrifices over and over and over again, the covering over of your sins. Through those animals being slain. Millions and millions of animals. The blood flowing. God was showing us something. Sin brings death and we're sinners. We need a substitute. We need a Savior. And these animal sacrifices had to be done over and over again. And because of that, they were imperfect. We need deliverance from this. We need rescuing from our slavery to the law and to its demands. See, the law could show us the righteous standards of God, but it didn't give us any grace. It didn't help us to obey. The law came with no power. It's just a rule. Do this. There's no grace behind the rule. There's no love behind the rule. It simply is the standard. Here it is. Pass or fail. There's no mercy behind the commandment. And this was life. This was what people were living in. And into that time frame, God sends forth His Son. And He doesn't send Him as a conquering hero. He sends Him in humility and in weakness. Think of it. Born in some obscure backwoods town. Born in a stinky stable, as the kids in the video pointed out very clearly. Born in humility, not born in a palace, not born in wealth and riches, but you mean born in weakness, in helplessness, to a young couple. Man, that wouldn't have been my plan. But what wisdom was there in God's plan? But something so small, this beginning so humble, so weak, could grow into something so powerful, so wise, it would fill and conquer the entire earth. Oh, the magnified wisdom of God, who takes weak things to shame strong things, who takes despised things to nullify things that are not. The incredible wisdom of God. To bring deliverance. And I don't want you to miss something else. I don't want you to miss this next phrase here. Born of a woman and born under law. Now, there's a few things we can glean from this. In the interest of time, we have to keep moving this morning. But note that he was fully human. That helpless baby. Fully and completely a man. Just like you and I. Flesh and blood, at the same time, the Son of God, God Himself. The mystery of that union. Unbelievable. But He comes in this weakness and in this humility. And He's born of a woman. And that's so significant because remember that it was in the garden through a woman that sin enters the world. We go back to Eden and we look at what happened there. You mean where Satan comes, you mean to Eve and tempts her. Lies and says, you know, hey, you can be like God. But you're not going to die. Just go ahead and eat. You're going to be like him. She gives some to her husband and the two of them fall. And the human race becomes sinful. We bear that burden today, don't we? Going all the way back to Adam and Eve in the garden when sin enters the world through Eve and through Adam. And Satan wrestles control away from God and says, now I'm now the ruler of this world. These people have now cast their allegiance to me. That's why in the New Testament we read that Satan is the god of this age, the prince of the power of the air, because he has temporary control over the planet. All through the sin of a woman and a man so long ago. But God's a master of jujitsu. And he takes what happened there, you mean, in the garden. He turns around and says, okay, Satan, you see that woman long ago that you tempted and brought sin into the world? Well, guess what? I'm going to take another woman. And through another woman, I'm going to bring about a child. And that child is going to crush your head. That's going to be my son. He's going to defeat you once and for all. And is going to redeem many people. He turned that right around on him, didn't he? The wisdom of that plan, sending forth, you mean, into the world in obscurity and humility. For this nowhere, nobody, young lady is one of a kind, one and only divine son. Wow. Simply incredible. And Jesus Christ is born under law. He grew up following the Mosaic law. He was born under that burden. But as he grows, he is completely obedient. Never at one time did he transgress the law. He succeeds where Israel failed. He was able to perfectly keep the law because he was God in the flesh. And because he was God in the flesh and he was perfect in every way, he became the ultimate sacrifice for our sins. And if he goes to the cross and sheds his blood and provides redemption for us, he's able to do so because his blood is superior to that of bulls and goats. Because he's God's one and only son. And when he dies on the cross, the problem of sin is forever dealt with. No longer a need for any more animal sacrifices. And shortly after Jesus' death on the cross, what happens to the very temple itself? It's destroyed. You go to Israel today, can you find a temple where they're offering animal sacrifices? No. Why? Because Jesus' the final sacrifice was given. That God, in the perfect fullness of time, sent forth His Son, born of a woman, born under the law, to do what? To redeem those under the law. That was his purpose. That word redemption is a pretty cool word. In the original language, it's ex agorazo in Greek. It's a compound word. The first phrase, ex, means out of. And agorazo means marketplace. Every town had an agora. At the city gate, it's where people bought and sold all of their goods. This is where the slave trade was conducted. Even people were bought and sold in Greek and Roman towns. Anything that you wanted to buy or sell, that's where you went. You went to the marketplace, to the agora, and you were able to make purchases. And when you bought something, you took it from the possession of someone and made it your own. And so a definition arises for this term of payment of a price to deliver the power of another. Out of the marketplace, out of the power of another. That's what Jesus did. He came down to earth and he died on the cross to deliver out of the empty way of life handed down by their Jewish forefathers. He came down to earth to show a better way, to provide final and ultimate and complete salvation to all who would place their trust in Him, and to provide the power and grace for His people to live in obedience to God's commands. You see, in this very book of Galatians, Paul praises the Lord for His ability to love and to give Himself for His people. The law couldn't do that. The law did not love me. The law did not give itself for me. It could not do that because all the law was a list of commands. But Jesus Christ came and loved me so much that He died for me. And now He empowers me through His Spirit to be able to be obedient to His law, the law of Christ. No longer subject to the law of Moses. The law of Moses has been abolished in all of its totality. And now, we follow the law of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we stand in His grace and His forgiveness. And for the first time in human history, we have the permanent indwelling of God's Spirit who empowers us to be obedient to Jesus. So complete and so total was His redemption of those who were under the law. Again, put yourself back in that context. Put yourself back in those days, the continually burdensome being slammed on every day of how you failed. Every time you had to go to that temple. Every time you had to see that priest or Levite. Every time I'm back again. Here I am. Can you imagine? Over and over and over again. And then Jesus comes. He says, you know what? That's enough of this. And He gave His life as the final and ultimate sacrifice. As John said when he saw Him for the first time, behold what? The Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Born of a woman, born under law to redeem those out of the law, to deliver us from that slavery to failure over and over again, to empower us to live a life of obedience and love and service for the King of Kings. Then the last thing here this morning didn't stop there. The passage goes even further about what the Lord has done for us. And when we reach out to Him in salvation, the Scripture says that He adopts us as His sons. Now remember that this comes in the Greek and Roman world. Remember that in the Greek and Roman world, you did not really raise your own children if you had any money at all. If you were any member of society that was important, or middle class even, you really didn't have much contact with your children. They were raised primarily by the mother, but then at a certain point, at a certain age, especially sons, what happened to them? Well, they were turned over to tutors. They were turned over to schoolmasters. And they were raised and trained because, you had other more important things to do. Now, I personally don't have children of my own. I kind of think that's probably not too bad of an idea. Maybe some of you after a morning are like, maybe that wouldn't be a bad idea either. Could we just pay somebody to do that? But, that's the world that these people grew up in. So if you were a child, you were basically, in essence, a slave. You didn't do what you wanted. You didn't go where you wanted. You didn't, live your life the way you wanted to. You did what the tutor told you to do. You were in bondage. You were a slave to the tutor. You were enslaved to the law. But when Christ comes, He brings us freedom by adopting us as sons. When a child became between the ages of 12 and 17 in the various cultures of the day, he went through a ritual of becoming an adult, where he moved from someone who was just simply, not able to inherit property, to someone who was now a full heir and was given the full rights of sonship in his father's home. And there's usually some big celebration. Cultures around the world still celebrate this in different ages across the planet. But there's something really interesting here to think about. The fact that God adopted you, who was once a slave, and brought you into His family is a pretty incredible thing. Now, I know that there are people here in this congregation that have adopted children. And I can't think of anything more incredible than that. To take a child that is not your own, I mean, out of a difficult background, a background in which they've been abandoned or maybe even abused, and bring them into your own home and treat them as your own child and make them a member of your family, making them a son or daughter. What an amazing, incredible thing. Let me ask you this question. Let's just say that you were interested in adopting a child. You got connected with an agency, and they allowed you to meet and get to know, you know, a few children. And let's just say, I mean, those kids were somewhere in their teenage years. And you made a friendship with one of those kids, and they were a really neat kid, and, you know, I mean, God began, you know, leading in your heart. You're like, man, you mean, I really think that's the child that, you know, we'd like to adopt. And so you take that, you know, step further, and you go through all of the meetings, and you go through all the hoops you have to jump through, all the legal stuff. And then you come, you mean, to, you know, those final moments, and, I mean, the person from the adoption agency sits you down and says, listen, I just want to tell you just a few more things before you decide on this process. I want you to know this child's background, this child's history. That this child's grandfather was a murderer. That he was also, you mean, involved in the slave trade. I want you to know that this child's, you know, father was an abuser of children. I want you to know that he was addicted to pornography, this boy's father. You know, I want you to know, you mean, all of these, you know, list of things they did that have criminal records. I want you to know that this child himself, you mean, has had, you know, difficulties, had an addiction to drugs in his background. Imagine if you heard that laundry list of all of those things. Would you think twice about adopting that child? Oh, man. What am I getting into? Do you realize that that's exactly what God did for us? Think about all the ways that we failed, all of the ways that we have broken His commandments. All the problems and the issues and the struggles that we have, and yet God loved us anyway. And He adopted us as His sons. And He entreated to us all of the blessings of sonship, all of the privileges of being an adult son in God's household. Think about how wonderful that is. That we can go to our Father at any time in prayer. We have direct access to Him. We don't have to come through another. We can come right to Him. That we have the joy of knowing that He never cast us out, that we are bound to Him. And we have the joy of knowing that He has made us not only sons, but He's made us heirs. And that everything that belongs to Jesus belongs also to me because I am a joint heir of Christ. Think about that. And He did that for people who were so unworthy of it. Who were dominated and enslaved to the law. And He came and He brought to us freedom. He made us His children. Adopted us as His sons. And made us heirs with Him. See, this is Paul's Christmas message. This is what he says to us. This is what our God has done in the sending of His Son. By the way, folks, not only does Jesus own the cattle on 1,000 hills, but He owns the entire universe. And what's His, He says, is also mine. By His grace, by His mercy, and by His great love. Wow. That's what Christmas is all about. That's what He brings to us by His coming. The opportunity to be children of God. To have intimacy with Him. To be able to cry out to Him, Abba, Father. Wow. The closeness of relationship that was never enjoyed by those in Judaism, we have in Jesus Christ. As we finish, I want you to take a look at this picture. What do you see up there? Oh, he's like, that's my house. No, no, it's not my house. I didn't take a picture of your house either. But the story goes like this, that there was a man who worked for an elderly couple. And they owned a large farmhouse, you know, kind of like this. And as they aged, they always took wonderful care of the place when they were younger. And, they had, you know, a fully functioning farm with cows and, you know, all the animals. And, as they aged, they weren't able to take care of the place the way they once were. And as the years kind of stacked up, you know, things kind of, you know, got a little bit out of control. And then came the time where they had to hire out, you know, people to be able to come and help, you know, work, you know, on the farm. And this young man would walk past the farmhouse, every day. And, you know, he would, you know, go to work helping, you know, doing, you know, milking the cows and all those type of things. And every day he saw the condition of the house. And every day he saw the condition of the barn. And he said, well, you know, hey, look, it's not really my problem. I just work here. And then one day the elderly couple came and asked to meet with him. And they sat him down and they said, listen, you know, we don't have any children of our own. And we're getting up there in years. And so, we're looking for someone to be able to take over this place when we're gone. And, you know, we were wondering if you would be willing to serve as our heir. And, the young guy was completely flabbergasted, and he was just, like, you know, taken aback. And, he's like, well, you know, sure. I would love to be able to do that. And, you know, what an amazing opportunity. And, you know, the funny thing? So the next day, as he got up so early in the morning to walk past the place, he began to look at things, and he began to gather together a work list. And, before long, after he got done, with his farm chores, he started, repairing the fence. Then he started working on the roof that had, some issues with some shingles, missing. And he began to do some structural work and do some painting. And before long, he had that place, looking just absolutely immaculate. And I ask you this, what made the difference? What made the difference? What made the difference was that he was no longer a hired hand, but he was an heir. And all that he walked on and all that he touched would be his. The Lord Jesus Christ has made you an heir of his great kingdom. And folks, we have the opportunity not to serve him because of obligation. Not just, I just work here. But to know that his kingdom is eternal. And we can accomplish things for his glory. We can serve in that great kingdom. Use our gifts and abilities and talents for him. Because one day, we're going to be joint heirs with Christ over all of it. And while doing that now, we bring him glory. Don't miss opportunities to serve the Lord during this special time. Let's close. Father, thanks again for this great, great time of Christmas when we remember your great timing, your providential hand as you sent your Son in the fullness of time to come down to earth and to bring hope, to bring salvation. Father, to turn hearts from despair and discouragement to joy. To take people who were lost and slaves and to make them sons and heirs. Lord, we can't thank you enough for what you've done for us. Father, would you put it on the hearts of your people who have not yet signed up for this nativity to come out, to fill up those last spots, to be able to accomplish this great ministry of getting the gospel out. Lord, because we share in this kingdom through what Jesus Christ has done for us. We have a stake in it. We have an investment in it. Lord, I pray that we would care about your kingdom. Lord, thank you for all these folks here today. Remind them of your wonderful love for them and what you've done for them. In the name of Jesus and all God's people, said.
Please stand as we sing, Good Christian Men Rejoice.
In every joy, your heart and soul and voice, give heed to what we say. The news is Jesus Christ is born today. Oxford asked before and bound, and he's in the manger now. Christ is born today. Christ is born today. We Christian and rejoice with heart and soul and voice. Now you hear of endless gifts. Joy, joy, Jesus Christ is born for this. He has opened every door and can't pass me evermore. Christ was born for this. Christ was born for this. With Christian every joy, with heart and soul and voice. Now you need not fear the grave. Jesus Christ was born to play. Calls you off and calls you all to play this everlasting call. Christ was born to play. Christ was born to play.
Father, we thank you so much for our time together. We thank you for these children that you blessed us with to be able to tell us what they know of your great love. I ask that there's families here who come to see their kids and they do not yet know you as their Savior, that today they would understand and accept this wonderful, wonderful gift of salvation. We thank you for our time in the Word. May it continue to change us and grow us. And once again, I pray for good weather and good turnout for our nativity, that your gospel will go forward and lives will be changed and more children will be adopted. Thank you so much for your grace and your love. May the Lord bless you and keep you, and God's face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you and give you peace. In Jesus' name, amen. Go in peace.